Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the start of another vlog. Today I have just woke up and I'm in this new kind of like long dress turtleneck thing that I got from Korea. The quality is like meh, but whatever, I wanted it. It was like 20 bucks and I was like, sure. Today is a day off. I am going to hopefully get around to the gym. I invited Liz over to gym, but she hasn't gotten back to me yet, so we'll see. And then I have to shower because my hair is a disaster and edit videos. I have a updated skincare routine video that I need to edit. What else did I have on the agenda for today? Maybe I'll film something, maybe I won't. We'll find out. Just how my day kind of plays out. And I still need to make breakfast. I had a coffee so far, but I need another coffee. Today is like one of those days where I didn't wake up that easily. And currently, I have finally taken the initiative to start rewatching some of my old Japan vlogs. And the reason why I am doing this is because I feel like whatever I was doing back then, I was doing right in regards to my vlogging, my videos, just everything I did then seemed right. Like my channel was growing like crazy. You know, I had such a good audience, such a good community that was really like talkative, I guess, on my videos. And I feel like I lost that. I mean, for the longest time, I have been under the impression that it was only going so well because I lived in Japan, which, to be fair enough, is one of the main factors. But I feel like in between Japan and now, like, I was very much so a lost person. Like, I was in a very dark stage of my life. And now I'm kind of like back. I'm like happy, things are going well, my life isn't consistently falling apart. So I want to kind of get back to that. But to be honest, like, so far I'm like halfway through one of my old Japan vlogs, which was before Halloween, like October of that year. And like the vlogging style is the exact same. Like, I don't know. So we'll find out. The other day too, I actually did my closet organizing. So I finally got around to doing what I've been telling myself, and I think maybe you guys, that I'm gonna do for a while, which is reorganizing and rotating my closet. So that all my summer stuff is packed away, and then everything that I would wear during the colder months is out on display and easily accessible. And I'm just kind of looking and realizing I have more winter stuff than I do summer stuff, but makes sense since winter season in Canada is like 6 months long. So this is currently what my closet looks like. It's kind of obvious what colors I like the most. So much beige and white items. But what I did was I went to the dollar store and I got shoe racks, like $4 shoe racks, and I just folded up all my summer stuff that I wouldn't be wearing. So like shorts and skirts that are too light for winter or just don't suit winter at all. Dresses, t-shirts, tank tops, all that stuff is just folded up on these $4, $3 shoe racks that have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 levels. And just tucked away, and it saved up so much space. Like, literally for, I want to say, the past few months, it was just a spew of bags of clothes, and I couldn't close it. I couldn't even utilize my closet. It was just chaotic. So that's what that is. It sounds like someone above me is doing some sort of maintenance. Do you hear that? It's so annoying. I hate that so much. And I'm just like wearing this dress thing for the first time. It's kind of itchy. Like, I put it on last night to try it when I got it, and I was like, it's kind of itchy. I'm gonna like wash it, put it in the dryer with some fabric softener. It's still kind of itchy, but I love it anyway. In my Korea order, I also got this digestive enzyme. So they're basically little sachets of single-use digestive enzymes that you take while you're eating a meal that you know is going to give you a hard time, and it helps to break it down if you're someone who has problems digesting your food. I think it was like $60 for 125 sachets. Oh my god, I have no idea. Anyway, whatever. I wanted to try this out because I was watching my Korean diet vlogs and I noticed a lot of people use digestive enzymes to help them break down foods that were difficult to digest, like breads, noodles, meats, things like that. And I have so many problems digesting food. So I got these and I tried one last night, and I think it helped because I ate a meal that I know would mess me up. because they were like special ordered in, I want to be like stingy with them and only use them on times where I feel like I would have difficulty, because it was like expensive getting these here. Like alone, I think this product was maybe $50. Then just to get it shipped here was like an additional $30, but that also include like the coat and this dress that I got too. So, but yeah, I'm hoping I can find something similar like this in Canada if I feel like it works out well for me, because like it just wouldn't make sense for me to consistently order it specialty from Korea. But yeah, it's basically fermented ingredients combined into one like powder sachet that you pour into a glass of water when you're about to eat something difficult, and that's pretty much it. So I translated the side and it said it was like fermented barley, fermented brown rice, banana ferment. That's just really supposed to help you break down foods that are difficult. So we'll see how it goes. I've seen it like pharmacies like Shoppers Drug Mart and Rexall that they do have some digestive enzymes, but they're nothing like this, like nothing like that at all. They're kind of useless, to be honest. I bought them before the past year and I did not see any difference whatsoever. For my breakfast / lunch, I'm having leftover carbonara that I made the other night, and then I'm also having another coffee with oat milk and maple syrup, 1 teaspoon. I feel like it needs salt. That's one thing with my new diet is in the morning you can eat like whatever, as much as you want. Then in the evening you can't really eat much at all. Last night I didn't do very good. I had like a large meal around 6:30 because I had to work a double shift at work, which was me working from like 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. It was tough, man. It was tough. So yeah, I'm literally watching this vlog and it's like the same as my vlogs now. The only difference is like I went out a lot and showed videos of my daily life walking around Japan. Like there's otherwise like no difference. I am dead. I am watching the first like ladies night video that I went out drinking with Emily. Literally like what, 5 minutes in, we go to a bar, and then the next scene is us out of the bar completely drunk, like so drunk off of 3 drinks. Like, oh my god, you can hear it in the voice, like drunk voice. Emily's just all squinty-eyed and her hair is disheveled, and I'm like trying to talk serious, but I have my drunk voice on. I'm all like high-pitched and like, so I am dead. Like, hilarious. I miss these nights so much. I don't know how I didn't get sick, because like nowadays if I drink like 3 glasses of wine casually, like forget about it, I'm catching a cold. Like, man, it's hilarious. I need to do like a live stream of just me watching these old videos and reacting to them. Like, honestly, it's hilarious.
So currently I am repairing a nail because at work one of mine snapped in half. Cringe story time. I was putting something into like a little kind of like drawer where it's like a fine opening, and when my finger was coming out, my nail hooked on it when I was lifting it up and completely bent it. It hurt so bad, but that's what happened. So my fingernail completely snapped in the middle while the actual part of the gel. So I have to repair that one, even though they usually last forever, like a month. Like, it's rare that that kind of accident happens. So I'm just doing the repairs right now, and to do that I am taking my little grinder, like filer machine that I got on Wish for like $5, and then to remove the gel layer that remains, I'm using this thick grinder bit right here, which is a harder, higher quality grain, so it's more coarse, so it's going to take off more product until I reveal the natural nail bed. I try to be really careful not to take off 2 of my natural nail bed because I want my nails to grow underneath, so I don't have to do too many fake artificial extensions. I don't want to do extensions. I want to just be able to put the builder gel, strengthening gel over top, and save me a lot of heartache. But unfortunately the nail underneath also snapped as well, so I have to create an actual artificial nail extension. I get asked a lot of times, like especially as of now, to do a tutorial on how I do my own gel nails, but literally whenever I do it all myself from scratch, it takes like 4 hours. I'm not good at it. I'm not a trained professional. I just do what I've seen on YouTube videos from people like Christine from Nailogical. stuff like that, and it takes me a long time because I don't have that much practice. But yeah, so removing the actual gel that still remains, filing it down to the natural nail bed, a actual fine grain filer for around the cuticle edge. I just go in and I just kind of, it's a little hard to show, but I just kind of push back the cuticle bed, get any of the cuticle skin that still remains on the nail, and just push it back so that the skin underneath doesn't attach the gel and make it lift. So I'm going to do that. Once that's done, I'm going to go in and create the whole extension gel nail part. So cuticle is all pushed back. Now I can go in and trim the cuticle. These parts you don't have to do if you're kind of like uncomfortable doing it. For me, I've been trimming my own cuticles with a cuticle trimmer for many years. So you just go in and literally you just snip off the dead skin. You have to be really careful not to cut yourself. Like I said, you don't have to do this part if you're not comfortable with it. I've been doing it on myself for years. I would not at all whatsoever be comfortable doing it on someone else. Because when you're doing it to your own hand, it's easier to gauge if you're cutting dead skin or alive skin. Yeah. So that's all prepped and ready to go. You can either use an alcohol swab and cleanse the nail bed to remove any oils, but I personally have found that not doing that part and just kind of like grinding it down and leaving it dry has the longest retention for some reason. I have no idea why. I'm not a nail tech. I don't know what I'm doing. But this is the builder gel that I use. It's the Yayoi builder gel from Wish that I got. The packaging is terrible. It's leaking all over the place, so I have to find a better way to store it so it's not like upside down, but yeah. So unfortunately, I have to build my own extension tip because my nail actually broke itself. So you just need to have these kind of finger guides, I guess you could call them. You can also get these on Wish. I got mine on Wish. I think I got 200 for like $3. And you essentially just place it under your finger. If you've never had gel extensions before, this might seem really foreign to you. I'm sure there's really good tutorials online to do it, but essentially you just stick the dark part underneath whatever nail bed you have remaining, and then you pinch together these parts, and it all is very sticky, and you just pinch to create a natural nail shape, and then the top part sticks together as well to hold it in place. Then taking a synthetic flat non-fluffy brush, this one I have had for years and it's from Michael's Arts and Crafts store. Don't ever use a fluffy brush, always a very flat synthetic brush or else it's gonna get really messy. And then you just dive into your builder gel, mine's clear, and you take a little dollop. You can take a thick amount, but the thing that sucks about builder gel is when it cures under the light, it burns like hellfire and it hurts like crazy. So I always try to go in thin layers because I can handle that. And you just kind of create the tip. So you can connect it from the base of your nail and then pull it out to the desired length that you want. For me, I want about maybe a 3 on the little grid. So there's numbers along the edge of the little plastic guide. So I'm going to place enough builder gel so that I can get it to the length of the 3 or the 2. And I'm just going to try to keep it within the grid lines so it maintains the square shape that I have going on and not point it too much. And then once I have my desired shape, I'll cure it under the light for 90 seconds. Then I'll apply another layer and cure it under the light for 90 seconds until I have the thickness that I want. And I'm not gonna film that part because it's like pointless. Okay, I'm curing my fingernail under the light. I always feel like around 30 seconds in, around 30 seconds in is where it starts burning like hellfire. That's why I try to put on a thin layer so the length of time that it's burning for doesn't like totally kill you. The one time I had builder gel extensions done at a salon, it was so painful. I was like, girl, like I understand you want to get my nails done fast, but like this is not an enjoyable experience. Like I was literally like getting, you know when something like hurts so much or is so uncomfortable that you start getting like a cold sweat. That was me, like, the whole time. I was like, this is not an enjoyable experience. Like, please just do one extra layer and make me so uncomfortable that I don't want to come back. Like, the nails were amazing and it looked great, but like the pain, like, even getting injections doesn't hurt that much. So I'm gonna do the light for another 60 seconds, because the cure time on this hard gel is 3 minutes. So 90 seconds and then another 60 seconds to equal like 3 minutes. So that is hardened. I'm gonna do another layer. This one I'm gonna do a little bit more thick, because now I have that kind of like protective layer, I guess you could say, like that base layer. And whenever you're doing your builder gel extensions, you have to try to concentrate the bulk of the gel, like kind of make it more thick at the point of tension, apparently, so that if, you know, you hit something hard or your nail bends a little bit, the point of tension is thick enough so it won't snap. I mean, you'll still, like, depending on how hard you hit your nail on something, it will still snap no matter what, like what happened to me. But if you have a strong point of tension, you limit the how easy it is for it to potentially snap and break off. Okay, so now that my second layer is on, the gel nail is a little bit thicker and can support itself, I'm just going to remove the guide just by pinching and wiggling it to disconnect from the cured gel. It does not look very cute at this time, but that's okay. And now I'm just going to keep building it until it's a good thickness.
I don't know who is doing like construction in their unit, but it's really gonna drive me insane today. But Liz is coming over officially to go to the gym and steam with me, and then we're gonna try to do some work here. I'm gonna edit a video, and I wanna live stream me reacting to my old videos today. That would be fun if I have time. But my nail is done, it's fixed. It doesn't look the exact same as the other ones, just because like I didn't do it the exact same, and this one's a full extension while the other ones are my natural nails underneath. But yeah, feels a lot better, looks better. And this is probably like one of, oh my god, this construction's gonna drive me insane today. Like, why does this always happen? But this is like the best investment I've made. I've saved hundreds of dollars so far. I've been doing my own nails for 3 months now. That's $300 I've saved with an investment of maybe $50, $40. So I've saved like over $200. I definitely recommend investing in your own do-it-yourself nail kit from Wish. Saves you so much money. Buying the actual stuff from like a Sally's Beauty or any kind of official retailer, honestly, don't recommend it. I've done that before in the past. This is the exact same thing, same professional quality for a fraction of the cost. So definitely check out Wish. This is not at all sponsored by them. This is just me buying it myself and being like, why did I take so long to do this? Okay, everyone, it's later in the day. Liz is here. We just finished going to the gym. We had some catching up. We did a steam, and now we are having some Pico pizza. Gluten-free.
And dairy-free.
And dairy-free, vegan technically. It's vegan pizza. So expensive from Pico, but I love Pico. Yay. So I've just been noticing the past few days, the air in the city is so dry. Like, you know when the air gets dry because of winter and you start getting like TMI blood in your nose and it's like crusty and like itchy and you're sneezing a lot because it's so dry because the skin is just like cracking and stuff. TMI, but that's what's been happening to me the past few days. And when that happens to me, I start to get sinus infections, and I've started noticing it every single morning and throughout the day. Like, I'm getting mild sinus infections, which I don't want to happen. I can't afford to get sick. So one of my hacks to help prevent the dryness in your apartment on a budget without having to buy a humidifier, which half the time I feel like isn't powerful enough to actually increase the humidity in your entire apartment, is to just simply start to boil an entire pot of water. So you just kind of keep it on a low boil, so just the bubbles are kind of coming up enough to create steam. And the only risk with this is you have to keep an eye on it, because if it runs out of water while it's boiling, you'll damage the pot. But it will really increase the humidity. So currently our humidity in the place is much below an ideal humidity level. 30% humidity in the air is very dry. The ideal is anywhere from 45 to 55 for the ideal humidity level in any kind of atmosphere. So I'm gonna try to raise it to that level simply by boiling water. So I'll check back in on it in a little bit. Taking my digestive enzyme tonight because I had the half a pizza with Liz. We'll see how this leaves me feeling. I'm gonna try to take it every night after my final meal of the day and see if that helps me with my digestion. Because usually I have troubles after I eat the final meal of the day is where I get like a lot of stomach upset, a lot of pain, a lot of bloating, just everything to make me feel very uncomfortable happens in the evening after I eat my final meal. Even if it's like light stuff or not a large quantity, I just have a lot of trouble in the evening with digesting my food. So let's see how this goes. Like how I said, it's made out of like all fermented ingredients. It smells like ferment, like it does not smell good whatsoever. Like it does not smell good. If you are like queasy to like how things smell or anything like that, you'll probably hate this. Back in the day, I used to start every morning with a cup of water that was like maybe a half a shot of apple cider vinegar and half a shot of lemon juice, and I would drink that every single morning, and it was nasty, but it's one of those things where the more you do it, the more you get used to it, and it doesn't taste bad anymore. And I feel like this is probably the same thing. Like for me right now, starting to taste it, it reminds me of vomit, which sounds nasty, but I want to see how it works for me. And like I'm someone who's trained myself to like I guess kind of get used to nasty tasting things, so we'll see how it goes.